Hey, welcome to Speechless. We're glad to have you here this Thursday night. It is the 19th of December. And if you're watching this any other time, it's not live, so don't call in. But we definitely want you to call in if you're watching this live tonight. Our phone number there is 651-747-3838. If you don't want to call in but have suggestions or comments for or on the show, you can go to our email there, speechlessmn@gmail.com. Something new for our show is that we have a YouTube site, and you see it down there, youtube.com/speechlessmn, and you can find past shows there. And as usual, we have a fantastic, well, I can't call it fantastic, it's a disturbing show with fascinating, terrible information. It's a quandary. It's a tragedy that's taking place in our court system and in a particular family here in Minnesota that actually affects two nations, Canada and the United States, because this has become an international issue. And it deals with child abuse and financial fraud and even potentially drug laundering, money laundering, drug business. So a lot of issues involved in this case, and we're going to spend a lot of time on the show and get into it very quickly here. But before that, I just want to give you an update on Ray Widstrand. Now, Ray Widstrand was employed here at the SCC studios and was beaten up on the east side of St. Paul. Had severe brain injuries, cranial damage, and fortunately he had been on a path of recovering pretty well, but still had a long, long way to go. And once they felt he was healthy enough, they put back in, I can't say back in, but they put in some new brain flaps or skull pieces to fill in the pieces that were taken out or damaged, and you need to have them. But that surgery was looking good for a while, but his body has now started to react to the new skull flaps, and they had to take him out. So that sets him back a little ways. And so far, I think the action of the city of St. Paul, the mayor, and the people of St. Paul hasn't been real great. I don't think they've been supportive. Some people have, of course, people around the studio and some of the businesses in St. Paul, but this is your neighborhood, and I think the police department, especially the mayor and the prosecutors, have some explaining to do as to what's going on in this case. And why haven't these two girls who started the fight, who Ray came to protect, one of them, why has there been no charges brought against them for instigating a riot? Whatever, you know, they were doing something wrong. The police, everybody knows that this happened and who was doing it, but no charges. There needs to be something done there. And of course, evidently a lot more investigation needs to go on as to who are the perpetrators in this, because they don't really have a clear picture. So at least they're not telling us what's taking place. So continue to pray for Ray in his recovery, and he's just going through a particular hard spot right now. Okay, so we're going to get into the show right away, and I have my guest on today, Kimberly Sperling. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much for having me.
I appreciate you speaking out on this issue, because it is tough. It is,
yes,
hard.
Very much so.
And especially with the battle that you've gone through in trying to bring attention to it and being shut,
yes,
down by the system.
Definitely does feel like a battle, definitely,
yeah.
Unfortunately, yes,
yeah,
for many years now.
And kind of the bottom, the thing that just sticks out to me in all this, here's the bottom line in this. Your children were being sexually abused.
Yes, by their dad. My ex-husband, Mark Sperling, yes.
And we'll get into some of the evidence, but to me it seems that the evidence is pretty credible that an investigation should have been done.
Correct.
And declared as to why or why not they are pursuing or not pursuing the issues that have been raised.
Yes, but unfortunately I am not dealing with a legal system, so correct. I basically had to become the investigator, hire investigators, fled the country for several years, and have recently returned. Obviously, leaving a lucrative career, 5 properties, and my life behind is something significant must have happened. But a police cover-up and a illegal court orders and judicial abuse is very significant in my case. I'm well aware this is going on across the nation. We've got several layers of things going on in our specific case. And I was fortunate that I was able to get out for a period of time with one child, unfortunately not 3. And I'm back here, took my life into my own hands to come back a couple months ago and start fighting this again. And I'm now awaiting the next court order. We'll see what happens. This has been going on a long time.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, and a lot's been going on.
Yes.
For, in my opinion, even a short number of years. You know, because you go 2006. Yes. This is a short period of time if you're going back 2006 or whatever till now.
Feels like many lifetimes, but yes.
I mean, I was looking at the case, and boy, just a lot of activity.
Mm-hmm.
And
it was relatively quiet. We were divorced in 2003, and it was relatively quiet for a couple years while he was flying in and out of Colombia, South America, 50% of the year and every month, and being stamped in and out by the same guy. His name is stamped in the passport, and there was drugs found by my children in the house and prescriptions from out of the country, it appeared. Mm-hmm. They didn't have the, you know, RX symbol.
What kind of drugs?
Well, my kids don't know. You know, they just know that there was something hidden in the bathroom behind a drawer.
Mm-hmm.
And there was lots of thousands of dollars in $100 bills stashed in the house in different places, such as a T-Mobile box and his sock drawer, and wrapped in tin foil in different areas. And with a lifetime of criminal acts, I kept him on the straight and narrow while we were married, and he did have a successful career during that time, made a lot of money during that time. But he had been a bookmaker in Cotton, Wisconsin, previous to me even knowing him. Violent, very violent on the golf course, smashed TVs, smashed phones. If he lost, he threatened people. Of course, he threatened people if they didn't pay him, and he won. And then at some point, then his house was raided, and the IRS was after him, and he fled Wisconsin. So
that was before you were married.
Correct.
But you didn't know
before
any
I even
of
knew
that.
Him.
So when you say you kept him on the straight and narrow,
was later
was
in our
meaning
marriage.
You didn't know you were keeping him on the straight and narrow. You just thought he was that way
until
after the divorce.
And well, I didn't know about the Wisconsin issues or anything. And I really, I had a very stable boyfriend all through my college years and graduated from the University of St. Thomas with a business degree and was an honor roll student. And went on, got a wonderful job right away running a life, health, and annuity department for an insurance agency and got licensed in life insurance. And also worked for 6 years at a health club. And it was, you know, a relatively stable, had my own place, was furnished, was working, had purchased my own vehicle. And I just wanted to date. You know, I was 22, 23, and I just wanted to kind of have some fun time. You know, I had a good social life, but I'm a book smart gal, so I spent my time in school and dating the same boy and so forth. And there were a couple relatively short relationships after my college boyfriend and I broke up. And I just decided, you know what, I want to just go date for a while. So he was really just one of several people that was very casual at first. And in fact, I told him early on, you know, you're not the guy for me. And I anticipated, of course, we wouldn't probably date anymore after, you know, who would want to date someone that says, month number one, you're not the guy for me. But
he still pursued you.
Yes, he did.
And
it was a little bit shocking after that.
Yeah.
But, well, it was more of a time, I think. You know, he was just kind of the last man standing, I call it. I still considered him more
That's
of a...
rough.
I know. And, you know, he just wasn't... he was very dissimilar to people that I've chosen to have relationships prior and in after our divorce, too. He's really the opposite. He was very doting and nice, and I just kind of, I told him, you're not the guy for me, and he said, let's just keep it casual, have fun, go out. So it was just, it was several months later. He tried to get me to buy a home with him, and I didn't move in with him. I didn't want to buy a home. It was significant.
That's a warning sign.
He was always pushing for more, and I was not interested in really taking it to the next level. You know, he was somebody that was fine for now.
Yeah.
And I was really interested in kind of doing my own thing.
Yeah. But in the end, you ended up getting married. And you had some kids.
Yes, I felt manipulated into that also.
Yeah.
I feel like it was a plan.
But
more
still,
than anything.
But still, there were decisions you made. You know.
Well, yes and no. I'm a gal that doesn't usually have relations. You know, outside of long-term relationships. And I did feel manipulated into that as well. And there was some taking off of the condoms issues. So that is how I got pregnant. Actually, that's how I got pregnant with all three kids.
Okay.
And condoms were regular contraceptives. And every time I wanted to get out, he, and I'm not one, I mean, this is maybe not a something to go into too much on television, but anyway, that is why I ended up in the marriage and stayed in the marriage for so long, as I was, you know, I mean, I take responsibility. Obviously, we were having a relationship in that way.
But you, I mean, you would expect that to happen, the relationship to take place and stuff in a marriage context. And I'm going to just let your viewers know some of this information we're going to talk about when we get into abuse issues. You probably don't want your kids around. And so just kind of,
I agree.
You know, go on the YouTube and watch the show later or something like that. But this is not really for kids to be watching because there's some serious stuff going on here. But I think, you know, the main bottom line, and I kind of want to move on because, I mean, we've got so much to talk about, but you got married, and there's things that just weren't quite right to you in the marriage, but...
he was an abusive person in the marriage, too. Yeah, I mean, he was, you know, beat in walls, smash in doors.
Was he hitting you?
He did come after me. He chest butted me. Usually it was either grabbing my wrist, and he was a state wrestler. So it was either grabbing my wrists and just holding me. And I mean, I couldn't even twist my arms.
Well, was that during the time that
you had
already filed for divorce or prior
to
that?
No, just during the marriage. It was off and on, you know, the whole...
He had no hint of anything like that taking place. He's just,
Of me divorcing him?
Right.
No, I think he knew at various times that I wanted to get divorced.
Yeah, but not,
there was
not
things...
during the violence part. Well, what I'm saying is people... when a divorce is going to take place, people get violent. It doesn't justify it.
Oh, no, he was, yeah, he was definitely off and on violent. But that's his lifetime history, you know, in his family. He was allowed to throw tantrums and get his way. And he was always violent on the golf course. He was just a kid, always trying to get away with stuff, and had been picked on pretty severely when he was in school and so forth. And he just... He grew up without, and then was a picked on kid. So when he became older and state wrestler, you know, a wrestler is a way to have some control over people. You learn how to take people down and so forth. So then he started picking on people himself. So he just really, from his teen years onwards, that was his way he handled things, you know.
So you ended up, you decided to get a divorce in this deal.
And I filed twice. Two years earlier, and then found out I was 6 weeks pregnant, and then filed again 2 years later, then after I had the baby and nursed the baby for the year.
And at that time, the motivation for the divorce was the violence. You guys really didn't see eye to eye on a lot of things.
Just... Well, I married somebody who I didn't love, so that was challenge number one. But I'm a gal that will try to make bad situations work, and I'll often try too long for too hard, or too hard for too long, excuse me. And this was really just another, you know, although I didn't love him, I tried very hard. Although he really didn't have a work history, I worked with him at home, you know, what to say on interviews,
well,
did his resume for him.
And he ended up being quite successful.
During a time of our marriage was the most successful he's ever been in his life.
And he was making around 300.
His average, in 1 year he made 850,000.
Yeah, and
his 10-year average was 300,000,
Okay, so, you know, 200.
Yeah, previous to that, he made, well, illegal income, of course, because he was caught for the bookmaking in Wisconsin.
You didn't know that.
At the time that I met him. I knew about it after I was stuck with him, and he used that as his negotiating tool with the IRS.
Okay.
I've never really worked. Now I'm working. It's 100% commission. I'm only going to make $45,000. I've never really had a career. Now I have a wife and a baby. You've got to let me out of these several hundred thousand dollars of back taxes that he owed from his bookmaking.
So they were coming after him for his bookmaking.
And that's the point
profit
at which I found out.
Okay.
Yes, because he didn't file taxes on his illegal income, right?
Okay.
Yeah, so the point at which I was stuck with him and he was using me as the tool to negotiate with the IRS is the point at which I found out about the IRS and that apparently all of this was coming in the mail. And I never was a part of any of that, although they did take my tax refund and apply it towards his debt, although I had never signed anything, nor did I know anything about it.
Was that after you were married?
Yeah.
They
sent me a letter. And I was like, oh, geez.
But so
yeah.
He did an offer in compromise.
Yes, he hired an attorney.
And the IRS just said, okay, this is, we'll do this.
Well, he
looks
pretty bad, right. He's had very little income. He was 32, I believe, at the time.
But they never...
He doesn't have anything. We've taken everything. They had confiscated his Cadillac he had, paid off him. They had raided his home where they found his bets and bookmaking lists.
And they never charged him.
So
he never got charged with the crime?
You know, I'm not privy to what happened, but I know he did spend a few days in jail. He
somehow did get out, right?
Yeah. Well, I don't know what was negotiated. I wasn't married to him, and I wasn't a part of it.
Yeah.
I know that there was the financial issues that had happened in Wisconsin. We met in Minnesota, and I don't know what he was charged with or how supposedly what they agreed to in this whole crime, I guess, it was that he would cash out this only other thing that they could find, because they didn't know he had hidden $25,000 with his nephew in a trailer wall at his nephew's. The only thing that they could really track down besides the car they confiscated and his no job and, you know, nothing else and really in his life that he had was a retirement fund, and it was like $14,000 at the time or something. So they said, okay, you know, his point was, now I have to get married to this woman and I'm having a baby and I don't have any income and all of these things. Mm-hmm. And I was really the one that had all the stuff. Mm-hmm. You know, I had a good degree. His degree actually was negotiated for him by his father. So,
oh, really?
Yeah, it was not really graduating with
how
a real
does that work
degree.
Out?
Yeah, well, when your dad.
You mean you can negotiate a degree?
Just you can in some cases, turns out.
And
yes,
say,
and they said, we're going to just put your 5-6 years of all these schools and all these and getting kicked out of the golf scholarship and all that. We're just going to combine that here at, you know, the University of Wisconsin River Falls, where his father worked.
It was a degree in bookmaking?
It was in education.
Oh,
and
education.
They had to have a meeting with him and say he could never work in education. That was the degree they were going to give him.
But he couldn't do it.
But he was not allowed, and he needed to understand that.
Wow.
Yeah, so that's how he got his degree. I believe he has on Facebook something like Stephen F. Austin or whatever. He has a negotiated degree. I'm not sure if you could call it legitimate or not.
Through what university?
University of River Falls.
Oh, okay.
Wisconsin.
Oh, party school.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, so he couldn't even get through there.
Wow.
But his dad was like vice chancellor, I believe it was, at the time. And so there was like a little meeting about that.
Mm. Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Okay, I want to get into, you know, that's some of the beginning history that raises questions.
That's his own story.
As of right now, you don't have any clue of sexual abuse going on with the kids or...
Well, I would say that based on, you know, what we found in his credit cards and what the kids, children reported, I would say that,
You mean during the marriage?
Well, I didn't do any discovery during the marriage.
Right. Yeah, you didn't know.
Child porn and anal sex viewing. That was something that was found out after the allegations were already out. We asked for financial discovery, and I'm a speed reader, and I taught myself to speed read when I was a kid, and I can go through a lot of documentation and things and take it in very quickly. Well, I had huge stacks of discovery, like credit cards and bank statements and taxes. And so very quickly, I was able to come up with a list of he's doing tax evasion. He is taking deductions for things that he can't, including nannies that I employ as I'm their employer.
Mm-hmm.
And deducting amounts that go to, like, the nanny service, which is a non-deductible expense by the IRS.
Right.
And he was putting that huge amounts of income under their names and Social Security numbers as if he was paying them, which he wasn't. That was
on
his taxes.
Nannies
right,
aren't
the
reporting
poor nannies,
their income.
I don't know if they got audited and the IRS told them they all owed money. I have no idea what happened there, but he's still running free, of course. But there was several things. We're kind of going out of order, but basically we were divorced in 2003.
But at that time you had no idea that there was sexual abuse going on or there wasn't any hint
of it. We had a false sexual life as a married couple, even though our relationship was not good. He certainly was not deprived.
Okay.
So during that time, he was, when we got divorced, he was basically a dad that didn't come around too much.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I had full custody of the children. I had always raised them. I participated in, you know, early childhood family education, the Small Wonders, their preschool, the elementary schools, junior high, I sat on school boards. I sat on the ECFE board. Mm-hmm. I was a classroom volunteer. I was at schools constantly mm-hmm. for all the children. So mm-hmm. all three children's teachers know me. The principals know me. In fact, I mm-hmm. sold the principal, sold his home and sold him his next home that he's still in. And so the schools in the community know me very well for many, many years. We've lived in Lakeville since 1995. Mm-hmm. So after our divorce is when I became a realtor, but during the marriage, I was a stay-home mom under his full control.
Well, this
but
is
we
interesting.
Still had a nice full social life, you know, the children and
I. But this is interesting. You saying Lakeville.
Mm-hmm.
So I just had on my show in the last 3 weeks, Sandra Grazini-Rucki, who's from Lakeville.
Yes, I've spoken with her.
And her case. Mm-hmm. But that's so and there's a Lakeville connection going on here.
I think it's First Judicial District.
Right, it's First Judicial District. And
Dakota County and Hennepin County are very well known for corruption.
And we're going to be dealing with some mm-hmm. of the same judges.
Yes, I read.
In the cases.
I just recently read, Sandra sent me Michelle, her attorney, mm-hmm. Michelle McDonald. Sandra sent me her, their affidavits of facts and basically what she has written up about her case. And after Judge Warminger, who's blocked my case, which is typical in these corruption cases, after he had his hands on her file is basically mm-hmm. when hers went downhill. And then she was, I forget the judge's name that was.
Knutson.
Yes, Knutson blocked himself to her case. And it was after my same judge. When I returned here from Canada after the years away, still fighting, by the way, across the border the whole time and filing and trying to get help and talking to politicians in Canada, talking to politicians here. Well, anyway, when I came back, I immediately picked up the phone and said, well, I'm physically here now. I couldn't travel because I was a refugee claimant, and they had all my travel documents, so mm-hmm. I wasn't able to leave the country.
Leave Canada.
Yes, basically I had to sign, I know that I am...
Coming
you know,
back at full risk and exposure.
Mm-hmm,
and,
yeah.
Well, we're going to get into that, what got you there.
Yeah.
But...
right, we're kind of out of order here. But when I returned, I called for a court hearing date, and I said so I called in September when I came back, and they said, "Well, the judge is booked. He's doing mental commitments for the next month." Mm-hmm. Well, that's what they do to a lot of victims. A lot of victims of this court corruption, the judges will say that they're crazy, and they will mentally commit them. And I said, "Oh my gosh, that's in my book." I said that to his clerk.
And I know that. I've had one, two, three.
And so the Judge Warminger
I've had four people on my show that I know are decent people. And because of the court system, then they start calling them crazy because they start telling
the
story.
Yes. And they have to find some way to discount.
Right.
Yes. So...
I want to get back to...
I did find out that Judge Warminger is then participating, and in fact, his calendar was full for the next month, so they couldn't fit me in with committing people, mentally committing. Yeah.
So we're going to get back to that, but when you started looking through the financial records, doing discovery on your husband's records, and by going then, after the divorce, going into the records... You were finding some child pornography or potential child pornography. But either way, he was subscribing to pornographic sites.
Yes, he was.
And paying money.
Mm-hmm.
And you weren't aware of that during your marriage at all.
No, I wasn't aware during the marriage. Not that he wasn't doing it.
And all that is perfectly legal, except for kiddie porn.
Yeah, well, and this porn appeared to be like preteen age and also anal sex, mm-hmm. which is what the allegations were about.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that gets it. So you're discovering this, but then how did you find out what was happening to your kids? How did that come about?
Well, there were several crimes that he committed against me first. During our marriage, obviously there was violence, there was control issues, mm-hmm. there was berating me, you know, whatever I did wasn't right. Mm-hmm. He just, nothing was ever good enough.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, finally, I didn't grow up in an abusive household, and I didn't have abusive, so this was just something that I tried to really work with for a long period of time, and it just wasn't workable.
Mm-hmm.
So he never became a good friend. He wasn't somebody that I could trust or rely on. It was just toxic, and I just had to say, I'm done. So I did a file, like I said, first time in 2001, found out I was pregnant, which was was a surprise, but not based on his prior antics. Did stay married, and then as soon as the baby turned one and I weaned him, as I nursed the babies, then I filed again, and this time got divorced. Really, I only got divorced because it looked like it was maybe going to drag out for a long period of time due to his antics. His first attorney quit. He hired Rob Hill from Larkin Hoffman, and then it went straight downhill. And Larkin and Hoffman is a whole another story that actually we could spend a whole hour on that. But I found out a bunch of the legal things he was doing at work.
And it's okay for somebody to defend themselves. I mean, that's an essential right that people need and have to
have.
Because, you know, false allegations are real. They
We weren't having any allegations at the time. We were just getting divorced.
Okay.
You know, it had been violent and abusive, but I just wanted to get divorced.
Sure.
Then it was going to turn into a nightmare once Larkin Hoffman was hired and the first legitimate woman quit. And then I found out he was doing a bunch of illegal things, like telling his work to withhold his income, delete all his client files from the computer, and so forth.
And
so
transferring sales to
he was
employees.
Also funneling sales through other people and getting paid under the table and so forth. So basically, just announced this and said, you know, this is what I know. And I said names. And he said, what do you want? I said, I just want a divorce. And really, I could have taken advantage financially at that point, but I didn't. I just wanted a divorce.
Right.
I had the non-marital funds.
Which says a lot to me, because it's more important to get out.
I just wanted to move on.
Of an abusive relationship than to try to. And this
it
is,
was just non-workable.
I mean, I talk about domestic violence on the show all the time. And I think the number one telling of whether domestic violence is serious is whether the person being abused leaves, gets out of the home. But what I see happen.
Well, I physically had to stand up for myself also. And I think that when I did that, that was shocking to him.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it just wasn't something that was going to change, and it wasn't workable. So I just kind of counted my days. And I, in the meantime, you know, I had a business degree, but I had been at home for many years. So I spent my time getting some computer classes, retaking some things just to refresh my skills. And, of course, sat on boards and things with the kids and in the community. And then we got divorced in 2003, and it was very fair, in fact, in his favor. And then he got a passport and started going to Colombia, South America. Actually, he got a passport right when the month after we got separated and started going to Colombia, South America. And, you know, I really didn't care what he was doing.
You're moving on.
My life was full, and I...
Except you have an issue if he's down in Colombia and he ended up going frequently...
Yes, about 50% of every month. And I actually made a chart and everything.
So he's not going to see the kids during this time.
Yes. He was a vacant father when we were married. I was basically a single parent when we were married. And then when we were divorced.
So even when he was home for the 2 weeks out of the month,
the kids don't
remember him much. Okay.
Yeah. I mean, I was the one that was at every conference, that was at all the parent days. I was the one that... You know, I did everything with the kids. So he really was, some teachers didn't even know who he was.
Okay. So, and I want to, we got to, we're running out of time. It just goes really fast. But, so then eventually, how did you discover the sexual abuse that took place?
Well, the Columbia, South America visits were going on, and his behavior started changing. He started becoming more aggressive. And I actually rushed into my attorney and said, you need to change my will, and to the end of 2005. Mm-hmm. So we'd been divorced about 2 years, and I built a new home, and I had been modeling and doing some high-profile things, and then also had become licensed as a realtor. Mm-hmm. So I was now doing well in that area as well as television and so forth. And then his behavior started becoming more aggressive and more outwards. Mm-hmm. So he threw a tantrum a rageful tantrum in front of my daughter and somebody at Buck Hill, the ski area, because they had hand-selected her to join the racing team. They noticed her ability when she was there with the school and had called me to ask if she could join the racing team. And actually, 2 years later, she qualified for the Junior Olympics.
Mm-hmm. That's very good.
Yes, but we ended up fleeing Lakeville instead.
Okay. So this gets to be a very
falsified police reports and government cover up and a judge that refuses to look at binders of evidence and ignores all of it. And I mean, this was after he threatened my life at school. The school filed a police report.
But why was he threatening your life?
Because of the falsified police report.
Who falsified the police report?
The police did, Detective Watson.
And why did it, what did they have to falsify?
They covered up the child abuse and they lost the children's tapes from their evidence room and they falsified timelines and they lied about what people said and
so you
used
just,
words that we how, don't use.
So you discovered that he was abusing the kids. So how did you discover that?
After he had first committed crimes against me. So back to the Columbia, South America's behavior changed. I rushed in. I changed my will. The end of 2005, my will is stamped like January 06. And he threw a tantrum at Buck Hill. And he didn't want to pay $86. That's what it was about. And so he went into
making hundreds of thousands.
Yes, hundreds of thousands. And he went into a rage in front of the man that was recruiting my daughter and myself. And
did he threaten them? Did he say, I'm going to beat you up? Or was he just yelling?
No, he was just freaking out. He was just basically saying he wasn't going to pay for anything else. Like she needed to have a helmet, she needed to have goggles, she needed to have all these things. They were giving us severe discount, you know, on the racing fees and so forth. But so that he was paying 86 and I was paying hundreds.
In the meantime, he's going down to Columbia.
He's going to
for
Columbia
for 2 weeks of time. That's that's in a big expense.
Yes, and then he was staying in penthouses for free, and he was refinancing mortgages for Colombian bankers, and getting free plane tickets. And there was a lot of things that went on during this time period. And
so the crimes against you
started that weekend with the spray painted garage. The same weekend he freaked out. He also left four and six were the boys at that time, alone in the house, at least twice, left them alone. Just they were four and six at his house, and he left it.
For how long a period?
Well, they were four and six, so they don't know how long it was.
Oh,
but
okay.
He was gone for some times. And
because if you called Child Protection, they'd say, okay, four and six, you can leave them alone for 15 minutes.
No, you can't leave them alone for any time. I think they have to be 8 or 9.
Yeah, well, there's a timeline in there that they've established, so.
Yeah.
But this didn't meet that for their age.
No, he'd always kind of taken risks with the kids anyway, like the don't seatbelt them in, you know, just everything was just kind of a non-parenting. Yeah. He's not a parent.
On the spray painting,
yes,
how
so
do you
the
know
same
it was
weekend
him?
That,
I mean.
Well, I assumed that it was probably him. I called.
And who else would do it?
Yeah, I called and I took a picture of my garage door, which the police did not.
Did he make any verbal threats towards you? I mean, he was angry, but not at this point in time.
No, he just spray painted FL, which is his favorite phrase, fucking loser is what it stands for, which is what he calls everyone when he's angry, and he believes everyone is calling him that when they're angry with him, or he thinks they are.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So then with the crimes that he was performing against you, that got you to dig a little deeper as to what was going on?
No, you know, his behavior continued to just escalate. It was the tantrum in the garage door. It was, then I was getting, I also have had since about 2002, right before our divorce, bought and sold and had rental properties. So I've had a lot of properties and I've been a property manager for 12 years. So, I was purchasing a property and selling another property, and I went to get like a $100,000 loan. And my credit came back, too many credit pulls.
Okay.
Well, I hadn't applied for any credit.
Mm-hmm.
And so I said, how can there be too many credit pulls? I've had long-standing credit since I'm 18, you know, so, and I haven't applied for any in the last 2 years. What is going on? Well, anyway, I got a copy of my credit report, and it was him from American Family Mortgage pulling my credit every few months since our divorce. So the last 2 years show up as,
which
he
has no legal authority to do that.
No.
None whatsoever.
Right.
And I'm going to bring an example in here. An example is these police officers in Minneapolis who were pulling files on a detective or a prosecutor or somebody, but an employee, but they would illegally go in and search her information. And she just won a $40,000 somewhere around there lawsuit for them doing that. And of course, you have a number of legislatures who are now suing the data practice people that have been police officers that have also been doing this or somebody in authority that is not to be using the services for that. Well, here's a non-government employee doing that.
Right. He's
which
a mortgage
is even far
broker.
Worse, a mortgage broker.
Yeah,
so he can pull things, but he still has to have permission to do that.
Right. And so I did also report that to the police, and he also...
Anything happened with that?
No.
No charges for...
No.
And
meanwhile, he's going in and out to Columbia. And
yes,
I did end up talking to the FBI, but it was 2008 by the time I talked to them. And it was basically a, if this is all caused, what's going on here? Because it continued to get worse.
Mm-hmm.
If what's going on here is caused by me reporting these things, then you need to find a way to stop doing that because it's sabotaging the kids and I, or you need to investigate lower government corruption. But that was later. So we had the garage spray paint. We had the credit pulls after a divorce. Then he ordered some enhanced faxing to my home just to, you know, cause problems. So all of those I filed police reports about. Nothing happened with those, but I was also... I had started meeting with the IRS in 2006. And the reason why I started in 2006 meeting with them was that after the spray painted garage, of course, tried to get, that was January of 06, I tried to get help and so forth. At that point, he owed me several $1,000s, had changed the medical plan to make a bunch of bills fall on me that was decided in our divorce decree. He was not upholding anything in our divorce decree.
Yeah.
And I said, I need to be reimbursed for all this money. So then he said, well, now he was suddenly going to make less income, and so he's going to take me to court and lower the child support. Well, he had an incredible deal. He was only paying child support for three kids and like $80,000 when he was average income of $300. Mm-hmm. You know, I just had given him a very fair deal, but right. our deal was, you'll pay for the three kids, the same percentage for three kids. You'll just pay it for 17 years, and I will just, we'll call it good. You know, I'm not going to pursue going over the state right. maximum.
And
I'm
going to
move on.
That.
Yeah, well, it was a great deal for him.
Yeah, it was a good deal.
So then he said, well, now I'm not going to make the state maximum, even though his prior year
so
was 2005. So
yeah.
then he said, oh, I'm going to only make $65,000. And, there was no findings. There was nothing. It was very weird. He, all of a sudden, the court just lowered his child support
down.
Which,
you know, I read that. And
yeah, based on nothing.
Well.
And then it had to, we had to
yeah, he
go and fight it and go.
He didn't provide any evidence that his income was this low.
Right. And it's and actually, it didn't end up being that low.
Right.
And it hasn't ever gone below the state
well,
maximum in the last
And I noticed
10 years.
You went to try to get an evidentiary hearing, and the court says, well, there doesn't have to be. And that's
yeah.
the statute. So there doesn't have to be an evidentiary hearing. But when it's contested like this, and there's that dramatic of a change, there
yeah.
should have been an evidentiary
there was
hearing.
No
and
facts.
Especially
yeah.
when you complained and said, no, this isn't the truth. I'm giving you evidence for the truth.
Right.
And then they just ignore it.
Yes.
But because they have the option,
years,
and it's an option,
it.
they can have an evidentiary hearing, but
mm-hmm.
because it's an option, then you can choose not to in order to cover up. You know.
Well, this did become, I mean, I do believe originally he was under investigation. I did go into the IRS. I did say, you know, there's tax evasion. There's, this is how the people involved in the mortgage fraud, he was doing huge amounts of mortgage fraud after our divorce.
Mm-hmm.
And I
well,
was
the,
actually finding out.
But the mortgage fraud was relating to his commissions.
No, he was actually doing mortgage fraud. He was funneling money through other people, Connie, Ben. He was his clients that he had refinanced five times were now his friends' clients being refinanced, but he was keeping track of them in his calendar, and then they were paying him under the table.
So
they weren't actually doing anything illegal because they're paying taxes and it's coming into their income, but they're paying him. And he's not claiming that income. But
so,
he was
okay.
also doing mortgage fraud. So he's one that has done multi-million
dollar mortgage
was,
fraud. Inflating the value of the houses
yes.
more than
he
they
would
were.
Threaten the appraisers.
And then
yes.
he would get
he had a
it.
Very bad, violent reputation about threatening the appraisers.
And with that higher value, these people would get more money, and then from that they can just give them cash.
Yes, lots and lots of cash. In fact, he was sometimes the loan funder.
Now,
he would give somebody
yeah.
cash, and they would pay him back the same amount of cash plus a couple grand for his participation, and because they didn't even have any money.
Yeah.
They were just...
Now, how can you prove that? Because that's something that's hard to prove
mm-hmm.
unless one of those people say, yeah, we did it, and here's the trail.
It would be relatively easy to go back through the properties. His properties that he was a mortgage loan okay. officer on. You know, as a realtor, I actually uncovered multi-million dollar frauds, and lots of people
mm-hmm.
came to me. I've always been one that, like, helps people.
Yeah, right.
So people came to me because I specialized in foreclosures and
mm-hmm.
short sales, and
mm-hmm.
there was a lot of fraud going on. So they came to me for help and in desperation, many of which didn't understand what had happened
mm-hmm.
and why they had these weird documents that said numbers other than what they were told. Like, some of them were legitimately, in fact, I didn't take on clients unless they were legitimately a victim
mm-hmm.
and needed help.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes I didn't take them on at all. I said, you know what, you need an attorney.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes I was out and about and I noticed something fishy. And
yeah.
when I looked into it, I could see the mortgage fraud. So I turned in, and this is also in my book, just a couple different things. Of course, I deleted the names of who they are. But those are my actual emails to the IRS. Like, here is multi-million dollar huge development. This is fraudulent, and this is why I believe so, and here's the people, here's the properties, and this is how it was, and so sent the data to them. Mm-hmm. And nothing really has happened except I have been severely persecuted and he has gone free, and we're talking about mortgage fraud, tax evasion, drugs, child porn, federal crimes against myself. He did threaten my life at the school. That was all later to come. I mean, it just continued to amp up, and we're still victims. Mm-hmm. And there's still a cover up. Mm-hmm. And it has really only ever grown. In fact, there were some very scary things that happened when we were in Canada and we wouldn't come back. And I'm lucky to be alive, quite frankly.
Yeah. Well, we're running out of time. We only got about 5-6 minutes left. So, and we got a lot of material, so we're going to have to make it short. But when you're saying he's doing drugs or selling or...
Oh, he even would pop pills in front of the kids and say, you know, that he needed them for driving or whatever. And then he would, 20 minutes later, be saying stuff like, "They're trying to box me in," you know, and speed up because he believed, you know, the cars were after him. And I mean, he really,
kids are telling you this.
The kids would report all of this strange behavior. Okay. There was a change in the children's behavior. So first the crimes against me, and I was uncovering all of this. Mm-hmm. Then there was a change in the children's behavior. But they really weren't telling me anything, and
they're young, so how did they express
it? And they were young, and they didn't understand because they would feel funny after they drank Gatorade at his house before bed.
Yeah.
So it was hard for them to even understand what was going on.
Mm-hmm.
My daughter happened to awaken when she was, I don't know how much we want to go into here, but she awakened during an assault.
That would be good enough.
Basically, her eyes opened. She wasn't able to move, mm-hmm. and she wasn't able to scream or do anything, but she could feel and see, and then her eyes rolled back in her head, and she couldn't understand what that was about, but we did make a trip to the doctor. And
So how much time lapsed between that and the trip to the doctor?
Probably a couple weeks.
Okay.
Yeah, because she ended up having a rash and a yeast infection, bacterial infection, and like a lot of non-little girl things that don't happen when, you know, you don't get these things when you're 10. And she didn't understand at the time, like, because it wasn't vaginal.
Mm-hmm.
She didn't. And I don't think she would have understood even if it was. But mm-hmm. but all of these things, awakening, seeing, feeling, things, descriptions of a man, you know, her dad, that is simply not something a 10-year-old is aware of how any of it.
So when you found out about this, then what did you do? You took her to some... Did you take to
well,
the police?
Well, she didn't. First, we went to the OB, you know, and addressed that. And her behavior had changed, but she didn't share those things with me until later. And it was kind of months of putting things together. Like, I had, you know, bad feelings, mom vibes, but I'm certainly not one to falsely accuse anyone. In fact, I'm a little bit rigid when it comes to... I'm very detailed and very documenting, and I really want facts. I don't want to deal with fluffy stuff. I really just only want facts. So these binders that we have on the table here are all facts I had to put together.
A lot of information. This is very shocking. And my point in the shocking nature of this, because if you're going to a therapist and the kids are going and they're saying something.
Well, immediately, called the school.
But,
and there was another little boy involved in some of it. So then he upped it to outward
things. And so their parents finally said something because...
Well, the school said, "Have you talked to the parents?" And I said, "Well, I will call." And so I called and I said, you know, I heard this from my children, you know.
Have you heard anything?
And the mother said... Oh my gosh, you know, I am going to ask my child. And so then she called me back and she said, it's true that my child admitted it.
So one of the issues was he forced one of your boys and one of their boys into the the shower.
He forced him into the shower.
He was taking pictures of them.
He had his cell phone out and faced at them. He wanted them to strip naked in front of him and to get into his glass enclosed shower, and they had to shower together. And the entire time he had his cell phone out like this. So the boys were like, why do we need to shower together? Why do we need to take off all of our clothes? Right. And is he text messaging? They didn't know why his phone was out in front of him.
Didn't he also make your sons call people?
He would make the kids go into his work and on one-way webcams talk out of the country to people they couldn't see and answer personal questions. And I kept addressing this with him, like, who are these people and what is going on? And he was doing that at his office. And this isn't safe for the children. And
that's weird. That is just weird. But this was told to a therapist.
Yes.
And nothing was done.
Therapist, but number one of nine total that the kids reported abuse by him and weird things and all sorts of. Okay. All sorts of allegations, and I wasn't in the room.
We only got about a minute left.
Yes.
But the therapist, their mandatory
reporters.
The police
refused to investigate. Detective Watson.
But did the therapist report it?
She knew we went in to report it.
But she didn't report it. She has to.
She didn't. She knew I went in and reported it.
It's meaningless, though. I mean, it's not meaningless that you report it. It doesn't matter. It's still her responsibility to report it.
Well, I agree. She probably has some liability there.
Yeah.
But we're dealing with, something that's gone on now since 2007, and the cover-up continues.
Well, and with your corruption. daughter, she started out, from what I understand, saying this was a dream she had.
She didn't understand why her eyes opened. She didn't have her pajama bottoms on.
Uh-huh.
And the way she described it to me was extremely detailed.
Yeah. You know what? We're done. All right. Remember, we're done. We're going to have you back, Kimberly. There's just a lot more going on here.
Yes.
But remember, if you don't stand up for other people's liberties, who's going to stand up for yours? And good men don't do nothing.
Yes.
God bless. Have a great week.
On fire and the wind takes the kite as the firefly brings the light. You said to me that you wouldn't leave, but now I see that you're lost.